Hello and welcome back to this second part of our exploration of subsurface scattering in Renderman for Maya. Now, if you've watched the first part of this tutorial, you'll see this is roughly the level we got to partway through there with just a solid cylinder. So we actually made it into a pipe later and put a light inside just to see backscattering. Now, this isn't the whole story of subsurface scattering by a long way. So we're going to have a look at some more of the settings for subsurface moments, but let's just have a look at what our scene is to start with. Very simple scene. I've got a plane, a cylinder, and an area light, a Renderman area light. So it's reasonably far away, quite small. The reason for this is in the first tutorial, we were looking at the effect of subsurface scattering on the interface between our light and dark. Our shading here, the shadow area. So we get this terminator here is softened by subsurface scattering. Okay, now this is part of what subsurface scattering is. I just went to see Iron Man last night and there's a lot of subsurface scattering effects in there without giving any spoilers. So let's have a look at some of the other aspects that subsurface will give us in this material. Now I started off with a Renderman matte material, just so we're not being confused by any other specular reflections or anything else. So let's go back down to our subsurface controls in our matte material. Subsurface controls are here. Now previously we just looked at these settings here. So diffuse mean path. Let's just get our tooltip back up here. Sorry, one moment. One second, it will actually do it. So diffuse mean path, it's the average distance that light will actually penetrate. So that's how far into this material it'll penetrate. And this is basically the tint which will be reflected back from that. Now that's not the full story by a long way. We have been ignoring these sections up here, which are the main tint and the albedo tint. Now, what do these do for us? Well, the main tint, my understanding of it to date, is the main tint is how light is scattered when it actually enters the material. Okay? So if I was to increase this to, say, a pinkish color similar to our subsurface, let's leave it at that color for the moment, and I'll do a quick re-render. Now, my renders look slightly grainy at the moment because my shading rate is set to 5. Let's do a quick re-render here, it'll take a couple of seconds. So we'll see the result here is somewhat unexpected in that the entire object is becoming the shade of that color, of our tint. Now, with a little bit of thinking, this is quite understandable because our albedo here is actually the ratio of the amount of light which is incident, which is coming in, and the amount of light which is being reflected. And when the albedo is set to pure white, all of this tinted light which is penetrating here is bouncing back out. So that's actually meaning we're getting this color is overriding the surface color. Okay? So to an extent you can think of the albedo as, for instance, the diffuse gain for subsurface. It's one way of considering it. So if I was to actually drop this albedo down, okay, and re-render, well, we'll see we're getting a very gray looking effect here now. There is a reason for this also. Currently in my material settings, I have the diffuse mix set to being incredibly highly biased towards the subsurface scattering, which is not necessarily what we want. Basically, the color which we're seeing here is very much the subsurface color. So if I drop this down, let's have a look now and re-render. Okay, so this is a balancing act. We're now getting more of the color of the actual diffuse, the surface color coming through, but but the object is still not looking to have an awful lot of subsurface. The reason for this is I dropped the albedo a bit low here. So when I pump the albedo slightly up to get more subsurface coming back, and I re-render, we start to get more of that warmth back in the terminator between the light and the dark, and we also start to get some nice subsurface happening in the general material here. So I can pump it back up slightly further still. Again, this will always be a balancing act. And it warms up and it warms up. Now, with all of these tints, okay, we can actually plug in materials. And plugging in a material to the albedo tint itself, if I was to pump this up to extremely high level, okay, almost pure white, we're seeing quite a pinkish color. Hopefully you can see that. I'll make this color even brighter. I'll push it slightly further towards saturation. But remember, pushing it to 100% saturation doesn't get very good results. It actually cancels out your subsurface in a lot of cases. So let's just pump it up slightly further. Okay, re-render that. Now, while that's rendering, I'll just describe what I'm going to do now. I'm going to drop in a procedural texture into the albedo tint. So we'll actually see the effect of the albedo is not consistent throughout the material. So for instance, areas where you've got veins will reflect differently from areas where you have subcutaneous fat, or where you have muscles, or where you have bone. As this is more like a candle, let's just make it a little bit sort of funky candle. And I'm just going to use I'm going to use a fractal. Now I'm going to actually make my fractal pretty much biased towards the white end of things, so I'm pushing this towards white. Okay, fiddling with these. Level minimum. Okay. Frequency down. Okay, that image kind of should work. So what's some coming back from there? Okay, so that's actually just been plugged in to my albedo tint. And you can play with this. You can obviously paint textures. Painted textures for these is what we would actually expect in the real world in production. But yes, you can use procedurals. So I'm just going to re-render this. So in this case, we are seeing something happening here, where we have the shaded area, but it's hard to see in actual fact in the lighter area of the image. So I'm going to push up my diffuse mix a little bit more and re-render. And we're starting to see what appears to be, well, that's an unfortunate texture seam down there. I didn't UV unwrap this. I'll rotate this around just for a second because it looks unsightly. Let's just rotate this around slightly. There we go. So that's a texture seam, which is just slightly annoying. And I'll pump up my diffuse mix slightly more. So it's looking as if we actually have something happening inside here, inside this candle of ours. The albedo tint is actually how much light is being reflected. So in areas where our procedural texture is darker, we're getting very little light reflected internally. where it's lighter, we're getting a lot of it reflected. The tint is the color. The albedo tint is how much light is being reflected as opposed to how much light is being absorbed. And the diffuse mix is how much of the surface color we're actually seeing, the original surface, as opposed to the light which is scattered in the subsurface. Okay? The DMFP color is the actual tint which the light is receiving on its exit. So there we go, that's a little bit more on subsurface. I will try and actually work on some example projects for you at some point, but I just thought it's worthwhile demonstrating this. So again, we can actually drop textures into anywhere we have a texture slot. I'll just render this with slightly higher shading rate to show you the final result, which we can actually receive with this. So just bear with me a second. I'm just going to freeze frame. So in actual fact, I did just a little bit more tweaking while we were waiting for a render there. I just tweaked the noise somewhat. Diffuse mix to get this kind of result. One of the most interesting things which we can see here in actual fact is where we have direct light and diffuse mix is set reasonably middle-ish, we're actually getting the surface color, which is this white color here, is dominating. Where we're in shade, because there is very little light coming or hitting this surface, the light which we mainly see here is the subsurface. Okay, so it's worthwhile noting that, and we get a lot more of the detail here. The fractal pattern is coherent throughout the whole thing. Now, one thing which I'm just going to look at now for you is, at the moment I have both my tint and my DMF color set to very, very similar, so it's difficult to separate them. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to actually set this to a significantly different, so let's just go to a bluish color, and remember, drop our saturation down, and quickly look at the results of this. It may help you to visualize, in actual fact, what is happening, the difference between the internal and external tint. So it's the light which is being scattered when it enters, and the light which is being scattered as it's leaving. Because these are more or less complementary, it's actually hard to see where they occur. But if we have a look at this area here in particular, it's turning out black. Because they're complementary, that's actually being cancelled. So in other words, this color and this color are more or less complementary. When that happens, this, rather than being increased, is reduced down to almost zero. So we were getting quite a nice effect there before when they were similar. Let's just push that back up to what it was before. Just so you can see this color here is actually boosted quite significantly. We get a warm, almost lowish kind of feeling from it. Okay, let's re-render that. Hopefully this has helped to explain a little bit more of what's happening with subsurface. There's a lot of material on the Renderman site and on other sites that actually explain the physics and the computer graphics elements of subsurface scattering. Now you can see what we have here, that area that's turning out extremely black actually has a nice, much nicer effect to it now. Okay, so we're getting a kind of warm between these colors here. Hopefully this is correct. Not absolutely perfect, or sure that everything I'm saying is perfect. If people have any advice, please come back and suggest things. I will make changes. So thanks very much for the moment, and I look forward to our next